Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
The next day, in Memphis, Tennessee, Martin Luther King was assassinated on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel. What he didn't know is that day he was preaching his own eulogy. That day he was preaching his own eulogy, and when he made the statement, it really doesn't matter now because I've been to the mountaintop. And I don't mind, because I've been to the mountaintop and I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want to let you know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. And for this reason, I'm not worried. I'm not fearing any man, because mine eyes have seen the coming of the glory of the Lord. My favorite sermon, the mountaintop sermon, where he speaks and says, it's all right. I realize my death is imminent. But I'm going to tell you, God has shown me that there's a new America that's coming. And I'm going to tell you, we stand on the shoulders of men like that, that caused such a shift to happen in our country. It's not where it needs to be, but it's certainly not as bad as it once was. And that's why we celebrate Martin Luther King. But I think sometimes we forget that this was not a political movement. This was spiritual. People forget that really Dr. King was a pastor, a prophet. And even though the boulder of segregation, the boulder in Memphis during that time was unequal wages, the garbage men were doing the same job as their white counterparts and was making 50, 60, 70% less than everyone. And he said, this isn't right. We're doing the same thing. How could we make less just because of the color of our skin? But when they gathered together, they prayed about it. When they gathered together, they preached about it. They ministered about it. They strategized and say, well, what does God's word say on how we should handle this? And his principle was to look to Jesus. He'll fight this battle for us. And I'm going to tell you, the next day when Dr. King lost his life, America was never the same. But nevertheless, it really sparked change to come into our world. Dr. King's favorite gospel singer was Mahalia Jackson. And she used to sing this song, How I Got Over. My soul looked back and wonder how I got over. When I look back at how we made it over, as soon as I see Jesus, oh yes. The man that died for me, oh yes. The man that bled and suffered and hung on Calvary, oh yes. I want to thank him for how he brought me. I want to thank him for how he taught me, oh yes. I want to thank God for how he kept me, oh yes. I want to thank him that he never left me, oh yes. Thank God for giving me vision, oh yes. I'm going to thank him because one day I'll join that heavenly choir, oh yes. I want to sing and never get tired, oh yes. My soul looked back and wonder how I got over. There's so many songs and people like that through the civil rights movement. And sometimes we think that it was merely political, merely about marching, merely about the signing of bills. No, it was a spiritual movement. The only way that they would overcome the boulder, which was America during that time, was if God brought them over. And y'all do know the same is true today. With every boulder that you face, with every boulder that you have to carry, the only way you will make it over is by your faith, is by a spiritual movement of God. There's certainly people that want to erase this side of history. It ain't nothing to erase. It's something to celebrate, y'all. It's nothing to whitewash. It's something to look and say, look at what God did. It's nothing to try to lie about or manipulate. You know, I've heard people say, you know, well, when they brought your people from Africa, you guys knew nothing about God. We introduced you to Christ. That's a lie. Jesus was in Africa way before Europe. Let's face it, the gospel came to Africa. It was birthed in Africa. There is no such thing as Middle East. You don't see that in the Bible. It's Northern Africa. And then if you really want to get into the southern and mid-regions of Africa, in Acts chapter 9, the gospel went to Ethiopia well before Paul took it to Europe in Acts chapter 17 and chapter 15 through 17. So what does that mean? That means Jesus was in Africa way before it got to Europe. So we certainly didn't need slavery and civil rights to teach us about Jesus. We knew about Jesus. But what should we look at this history and say? We should say, look at what God brought us from. White folks, black folks, Hispanic folks, Asians should all celebrate and look and say, we stand on the shoulders of a preacher, a prophet that looked over and said, I've seen the promised land and I might not get there with you, but God has shown me that this country is changing. That should be something that we celebrate, not whitewash, y'all. And I'm always grateful for these Sundays when we get to look back and say, wow, look at what God has done. We started something new this year, boulders and backpacks, backpacks and boulders. What are boulders? Galatians 6:1 says, bear one another's burdens, bear one another's boulders. But then in 6:5 it says, but carry your own load. Life certainly has its challenges. You will experience trespasses or sins that are heavy. You'll experience problems that are heavy. And what are we supposed to do? Not throw people away. We're supposed to help bear one another's burdens, bear one another's boulders. But then not only that, there's some things you need to carry in your own backpacks. That's why he says, carry your own load. So we got responsibilities in this life. And many times we look at New Year's and we say, okay, God, this is a boulder that I had to deal with that I want to make sure gets dealt with in this year. Or some people say, you know, I'm going to start doing something new. I'm going to carry something new into the new year. I'm going to start an exercise routine. I'm going to start a Bible study routine, start a devotion routine. These are all things that I'm going to carry in my backpack to help me get closer to God, or start financial money management, or start different things. Yeah, those are great things that you need in your backpack to walk with God. But today I want to talk about boulders. Some things are just too heavy for us to carry. But today, here's what I want you to get. You can overcome every boulder in your life by faith. Every boulder in your life by faith. As immense as all of the issues in America, Dr. King was crazy enough to believe we can overcome this by faith. Do you realize in Dr. King's day, if there was a black family that didn't have a dentist in their community that was black, they would have to go to a veterinarian to get teeth pulled. Can you imagine the same vet that works on a dog will work on a person of color because a regular dentist couldn't be seen, wouldn't see them? That was normal in America. And there are several things that are just like that, whether if it's the segregated water fountains or the unequal opportunities that were in Memphis that Dr. King was standing for. But he was crazy enough to believe, to say, I looked over and I've seen the promised land. He was crazy enough to believe that my faith is going to help us overcome this boulder. And I'm just crazy enough to believe that if you trust in Jesus, every boulder that you are carrying, you can overcome. Your faith is how you're going to overcome boulders. Your faith is how you're going to lift loads that are too heavy for you to carry. Your faith, your faith, your faith. Today, I want to challenge you to take a step of faith. Take a step of faith, and I promise you, whatever boulder you are carrying, it may seem too hard, too large, too big, but my God is bigger, my God is greater, my God is stronger than anything you can carry. This man, Dr. King, could look and see all of the boulders in this world and say, with God, we're going to overcome this. His favorite song, we shall overcome someday, someday. What was it about? Through faith, we'll overcome. This is described beautifully in Hebrews chapter 12. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 12. Let's read verses 1 through 3. Y'all can stand with me. Hebrews chapter 12. Verse 1 through 3. Listen to this. Therefore, since we have this great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every weight or boulder and sin which so easily entangles. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. And our subject for today is overcome the boulders of life by faith. Overcome the boulders of life by faith. This first verse says, therefore, we got this great cloud of witnesses. I'm going to tell you, the civil rights movement was not a political movement. It was a faith movement. When it comes to things like slavery and different things that have gone on in this world, how did we overcome? How did the country overcome? It was by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith they overcame. And he said, look back at this great cloud of witnesses. It wasn't because they were so talented. It wasn't because they were so strong. I mean, think about it. During that time, every power system was not owned by black folks during that time. How in the world did these progressions get made? How in the world did black folks just not get annihilated during that time? Why? It was because some people had faith. They had faith. Mahalia Jackson, she sung, "My soul looked back and wonder how I got over." It was by faith. Martin Luther King would sing, "We shall overcome someday." By faith, by faith. Freed slaves like Sojourner Truth. Listen to the speech that she spoke to women as they were marching for women's rights. She said, "Ain't I a woman? I work hard in the slave and cotton fields. I was beaten by men. Ain't I a woman? Ain't I a woman? I gave birth to 13 children and all of them were ripped away from me and sold. Ain't I a woman?" Some will say women can't have the same rights as man because Jesus was a man. But let me tell you, Jesus, he wouldn't have been here if it wasn't for a woman to push him out. Ain't I a woman? The first woman, Eve, turned the world upside down with her choice. And it's going to take another woman to turn the world right side up. Ain't I a woman? What was Sojourner Truth saying? She's saying, look, by faith, a woman of God is going to usher a new era into this country. By faith, by faith. Hebrews 12:1 says, therefore, we got this great cloud of witnesses. What is he talking about? Well, you turn one page back to Hebrews chapter 11, and we call this chapter the Hall of Faith. All of these people were witnesses. They made it through life. They made it through struggle. They made it through sin. They made it through temptation. All of the boulders that this life could offer. And the only way they made it through was what? By faith. By faith. By faith. And the only way you're going to make it through is by faith. By faith. By faith. Chapter 11, verse 4, it says, by faith, we understand that the world's prepared by the word of God. And what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain. By faith, by faith, by faith, verse 5, it says, by faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death, and he was not found because God took him by faith. Verse 6, and without faith, it's impossible to please God by faith. Verse 7, by faith, Noah being warned by God about things not seen in reverence prepared an ark for salvation of his household, which he condemned with the world according to his faith. In other words, they're listing all of these people that had struggles and had boulders. But the only way they overcame was what? By faith. It didn't matter if it was Abel. Abel offered a better sacrifice, knowing that his brother was going to hate him for it and potentially would kill him. But by faith, I know God's got me. By faith. It didn't matter if it was Enoch. Enoch is one verse long. Enoch walked with God, and when he walked with God, one day he was, and then the Lord took him. By faith, he walked with God, and God said, you know what? Your faith is so good, you don't even have to experience death. God took it by faith. By faith, it says Noah, he preached a three-word sermon for 120 years. And nobody got saved. Every week, the text for the day is, it's gonna rain, three words. Next week, the text for the day, it's gonna rain, three words. The next day, it's gonna rain, and nobody ever got saved. How discouraging that must have been. But by faith, he trusted God. And guess what? The only people that were saved was his family. And who knows, his family probably didn't even listen. They went because you dad. I guess we going. When nobody else is listening, by faith, trusting in God. And I'm going to tell you throughout this whole hall of faith, verse 8, by faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed by going to a place which he had received for an inheritance, he went out knowing, not knowing where he was going. God comes to Abraham and says, leave your comfortable surroundings. Leave the moon god that you're serving. Leave all of this and by faith, go to a place where I show you. Abraham's family was there. His father was there. His inheritance was there. In other words, leave everything by faith. Trust me. By faith, he carried that boulder. By faith, he overcame. By faith. Over and over again, he said, Abraham, your name is going to be great. Abraham had no children. If you've ever been in a household where a wife is barren, there's certainly something about the pain of a wife that sees everybody else having a baby shower and she ain't having no baby shower. Everybody else having children and she not having children. And Sarah had to be, I'm going to another baby shower. God, you told my husband and you told me his name was going to be great and I still have no children. Can you imagine the weight that was on this? But by faith, they trusted God. Every issue that you have, every boulder that you have, you can overcome it by what? Faith. It didn't matter if it was a civil rights movement and looked at all of the darkness of America and looked at all of the mess of America, the pains of America. By faith, we shall overcome someday. This is why King could look out and say, I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the coming of the glory of the Lord. By faith. If you are going to overcome the boulders of this world, he said, look at this great cloud of witnesses. What is he saying? They went through the hardest parts of life and they made it. Why? By faith. Let this be the example to you that if you trust in the Lord, you may say, but Pastor, you don't know how heavy this was throughout this year. I don't want to carry this from 2023 into 2024. You better keep your faith. Trust in the Lord. He's got you. Yes. If they could look out at the pains of this world and say, by faith, I'm going to boldly stand before men that I know are likely going to kill me tomorrow and say, by faith, it's going to be all right. Hallelujah, God. And throughout this whole chapter, he just goes line by line. Remember Abraham, remember Sarah, remember Joshua, remember David, Samson, Gideon, Samuel. All of them, they overcame by faith. What is he talking? Why did he give this picture? Well, when you look at this passage, he says, therefore, we got this great cloud of witnesses surrounding us. Let us lay aside every encumbrance and sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. So you got this great cloud of witnesses. They ran their race. And as they ran their race, he said, look to them, they overcame by faith. But in this race, what did they do? They passed the baton to you. One of my favorite races that my son used to run, he didn't like it. TJ didn't like running this race, but I like to see him run it. 4x400. Initially, you have the third fastest start. And then, well, you have the second fastest start. Then they pass it, the baton, to the third fastest. And he's running his race. Then he passes it to the slowest. And they're running their race. But then by the time you get to the fourth, you got the anchor. And when the anchor gets the baton, they get the baton. Why? Because we expect them to blaze to the finish. And what he's saying is, you got this great cloud of witnesses. By faith, they overcame barrenness. By faith, they overcame poverty. By faith, they overcame all sorts of destructive things. And by faith, as they pass the baton to you, run this race. Run it by faith. So if you're going to overcome, the only way you're going to overcome is with your faith in the Lord. I'm going to tell you, in my own family, Lord knows God has brought the Andrews and Hester family from a long ways. I love to hear my mom say, my first job was working at a chicken coop. I know she looks very sophisticated now when you see her, but her first job was at a chicken coop. Look at her right now and see what God has done. I can go back on my father's side, and we're able to trace back to literally freed slaves that got property, and the property was taken from them. And they said, well, you can go and do sharecropping and you can live on the property. And they said, well, we're only going to do this for a little bit because we're going to own our own property. You took our first property from us. We thought it was 40 acres and a mule, and they took it. And they pushed them into sharecropping, and they said, you know, we're going to figure out how to get our own property. And Flem Andrews raised 12 children. And my grandfather, Wilson Andrews, came out from those 12. And he owned property. They owned property. And Lincolnton, that property is still there in Lincolnton, Georgia today. So when we go there, we look and we, and all of them were deacons and men of God in the church. They understood that if we're going to make it over, it's going to be what? By faith, by faith. In your family, you got a great cloud of witnesses. Some that made it over. You're here because somebody prayed for you. You're here because somebody believed you. Somebody believed that generational curses was going to be broken. Somebody was fasting for you, saying, no, the best is yet to come. They will not be shut down from this world. By faith, they will make it over the boulders of life. By faith. Then look at what he says in the second half of that first verse. So therefore, we got this great cloud of witnesses surrounding us. Let us also lay aside every encumbrance and sin which so easily entangles us. And let us run with endurance the race that's set before us. So this is where he says, lay aside the weights. The boulder. You know, it's hard to run if you're carrying a boulder. You will not be successful in running this race if you're carrying unnecessary boulders. He says, boulders and sin. Y'all know sin is a boulder, right? It keeps you away from God. Now, I know I got some track coaches in here and some former runners. Lakeisha's a track coach. Nicole's a distance runner from University of Mobile. Candace is watching online. She was almost a Bahamian Olympian sprinter. If you go to them and you ask them and you say, when you're running in track, what should you wear? You know what they're going to tell you? They're probably going to say, don't wear cotton. Because cotton soaks up sweat and it makes you what? Heavier. They're going to say put on nylons, to put on something that repels sweat. And I remember when I asked Nicole about this, he said, well, your coach is probably going to try to put you on something as least as possible. He's going to try to put you out there in a bikini. Why? Because he doesn't want you to be weighed down by anything. When you run this race, you get rid of every hindrance so that you can give everything that you got in order to run this race. And the same principle was here when Paul was preaching. Paul loved to preach sports analogies. And the sports analogy here is running a race. He said, if you're going to run this race well, now that the baton has been handed off to you, you got to get rid of the boulders. Get rid of whatever is going to stop you from running a good race in the faith. Does that make sense? Boulders, boulders, boulders. But then he says, the boulders, get rid of the weight and the sin that so easily entangles you. Sin is a boulder. And it pulls you away from running a good race for God. You know, I remember when my kids, when they became teenagers, they used to try to, you know, they grew up in church. And they preacher kids. And preacher kids do what they do. They try to challenge you, well, why do we have to do this? You know? Why we can't go? What's wrong with it? Show me the Bible verse that say we can't. Y'all know. That's what they do. And you know what I tell them? I say, well, what you're wanting to do doesn't help you run your race. See, a lot of times for us, we'd be like, well, it don't specifically say thou shalt not shack up. So because it don't specifically say thou shalt not shack up, what wrong with it, Pastor? My question to you is it going to help you run your race? Is it a weight that's going to drag you away from God? You can't tell me you're going to get fresh out of shower with your boo and not be thinking we need to be doing a little something else. It ain't going to help you in your race with God. It's not about the do's and don'ts. Is it going to help you run? This says put away every sin and every weight, every encumbrance. In other words, he goes beyond the Ten Commandments. If it's not going to help you run, it probably shouldn't be in your life. Some of y'all are like, Pastor, why you had to go there? It ain't me. That's what the word say. It didn't just say sin. It said every weight. Every encumbrance, everything that's not going to be beneficial to your run. Now, when I had a conversation where they'd be like, Pastor, so where does it say we can't live together? And I'd be like, just go ahead and live with them. It's cool. Do what you want to do. Because if I come up with a reason for you not to, you're going to find some loophole to finagle your way out anyways. So if that's what you want to do, do it. Don't ask me. Don't ask me to validate what you said in your heart to do. The issue here is will it help you run? Will it help you run? I'm going to tell you, there's some friends that don't help you run. You got to say, that's a boulder. You weighing me down, bro. There's some stuff in our life that is just like, this ain't helping me run. I'm going to tell you, you know, every morning I try, the first thing for me, I try to say, all right, roll over, 6:30 in the morning, it's time to pray. It's time to pray. That's why we have prayer calls, 6:30, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Why? Because the first thing you should be doing, giving glory to God. First thing you should do, thank you, Father, for waking me up. First thing you should do, before I get too far into my day, let me give it over to you. First thing. Why? Because it's real easy to start, oh, let me look at my phone. Ooh, okay, this happened last night. Let me go on. All of a sudden, your mind is in a totally different place. So I've gotten to the place where I put this thing on quiet mode, where the only thing I get is a reminder that says, get up, it's time to pray. Why? Because I don't need any extra baggage dragging me away from my walk with God. The weights. I'm gonna stop picking on y'all. I'm sorry. Not really, but I'm sorry. Because y'all know it's a whole list. Well, it don't say, what about marijuana? What about this? What about that? Does it help you run? That's the question.
Because this passage goes way beyond that and says, run this race. Don't try to find the loophole so that you can run this mediocre, lackadaisical, lukewarm race. Run with everything that you got. 1 Corinthians 10:23 says this, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful for me, but not all things edify. In other words, you can do whatever you want. Really, New Testament wise. But everything doesn't help you in your journey with God. And if it doesn't help you in your journey with God, you probably need to do some pruning. Boulders. There are some things and boulders that we have, which are sins, has caused additional boulders in our life. We read this passage last week, Galatians 6, and it's our theme passage for this time. Galatians 6, verse 1, it says, brethren, if anyone is caught in a trespass, restore him. Verse 2, bear one another's burdens to fulfill the law of Christ. Verse 5, each one will bear his own load. But look at what he says in verse 7 of Galatians 6. He says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, he will also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. In other words, what he's saying is the weights that we carry sometimes has consequences. Bear your own load. Carry your own backpack. But the choices that you make, whatever you reap, you'll sow. Some of the decisions we make have caused other boulders to be in our lives, and it's because we reap what we sow. It's that principle of sowing and reaping. So by faith, we overcome. By faith, the challenge that he issues to us is this: walk. Walk with God. Walk to where you're running a good race. Walk to where you're running a good race and put aside, lay down every encumbrance, every weight, every sin that so easily entangles, and run this race well. But then look at where he goes with this. Verse 2. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, for the joy set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that we will not grow weary and lose heart. By faith is the only way you're going to overcome. By faith, this is a walk with God that you're committing to, a day-by-day consistent race that you're walking with him. But you know what he says? By faith, nothing will overtake you. By faith, no boulder will ever crush you. He says, all you got to do is look unto Jesus. Look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Notice he said, look, we got a great cloud of witnesses. Look at the race that they did. In other words, they're a good model and example for how to finish the race. But Jesus was more than an example. He said he's the author and he's the finisher of our faith. He says, when you look towards Jesus, it's not just an example, but he's the race. He finished the race. He is the reason for the race. He overcame the race. He's the author and finisher of our faith. He's not only the model of faith, but he's the source of faith. Put your faith in Jesus, and that's how no boulder will ever overtake you. Speaking of a race, we got, like I said, we got some track coaches here. A track coach is going to look at a kid, and they're going to look at a minute and say, he ain't got the talent for this. Y'all have seen folks like that. He just ain't got the talent. He want it, but he ain't got the talent. This coach looked at this kid, and he really was slow, not athletic, and he was convinced, I'm supposed to run hurdles. The track coach was like, you can do it. Okay. Let's run hurdles. He said, I want you to look at what they doing. Look at them and see how they jump over. Look at them and see how, look at their form. Look at them, and whatever they do, you do. He looked and said, Coach, I'm ready. Let's do it. Man, all of a sudden, the gun goes off. He's running. He trips over the first hurdle. Trips over the second hurdle. Trips over the third one. The fourth one twists his ankle and breaks his Achilles. Why? Because just looking at other people were not going to make him a better runner or a better hurdler. But this one says, look unto Jesus, who's the author and the finisher of the race. In other words, it's not you just doing something in your own strength. He's the author and the finisher. He's the source and he's the model. When your faith is in the ultimate sprinter, the ultimate runner of life, he overcame every issue that you could ever address. So guess what? When your faith is in the source, he fills you with all of the strength that you need in order to overcome. It's not just looking, but he's the source. He's the source. Jesus is the one that if you look to him, he's the one that despised the shame. He's the one that overcame by the cross of Jesus Christ. And then in the end, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. When you look to him, he's the source of your strength to overcome any boulder that you may face. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Fix your eyes on Jesus. You see, Jesus faced every boulder you could possibly face. Some people are carrying a boulder of depression. Jesus was depressed. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he was wrestling with God in depression. And he said, God, if there's any other way, take this cup away from me, but not my will. Thy will be done. Jesus overcame depression. Some people carried a boulder of poverty. Just couldn't make ends meet. Jesus was poor. He said, foxes have holes, birds have nests, but the Son of Man had no place to lay his head. But when he was faced with not having food, he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. In other words, he overcame poverty. Jesus overcame loneliness. He went to his disciples when he was about to face the cross. And he said, can you stand watch with me just for an hour? And he'd go pray, and every time he went back, he was alone. They were asleep. But he wrestled with God so much that it said blood was filling his sweat of his brow. Jesus overcame loneliness. Jesus overcame temptation. So, some of y'all like, Pastor, he certainly couldn't have been tempted like we tempted today. Oh, yes, he was. Why? The scripture says in Hebrews 4:15, he was tempted in every way, yet he did not sin. Jesus overcame temptation. Every issue that you could ever face, he overcame it. He overcame it. Jesus overcame attacks. People attacked him, y'all. There were times where the enemy attacked him, the devil attacked him, others attacked him. But every time Jesus would step on the scene, it says demons would tremble and flee. Jesus was attacked, but he overcame it. And oh, one day, even the biggest boulder, death. The biggest boulder of death came to him.
And there was no way for him to escape it. He said, Father, if it be another way, please let it be, but not my will, thy will be done. You got to imagine when they crucified him, he hung on a tree for 6 to 8 hours. What did that mean? He was being tortured in every way possible. Death was coming, y'all. They nailed spikes in his hands, nailed spikes in his feet. They spat on him. They laughed at him. They literally stripped him of his clothes. There he is, hanging naked on an execution cross. Death. And you know what the enemy said? Surely, this is a boulder he can't carry. Surely, this is going to be too much for him. Surely, I got him. I killed him in the worst way possible. But even death could not overcome our Savior. Why? He's the author and the finisher of faith. When he said, it is finished, he went down to the grave, stayed in there 3 days. There were no doubt that he was dead, but even death could not hold him. Why? Because he overcame death. Hallelujah. Got up with all power in his hands. This is why it says, look to who? Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. He overcame sin. He overcame every boulder you could possibly face. And even the final boulder, death. So now as believers, when we look to Jesus, we say, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? For Jesus overcame even death. This last passage, Romans 6, 5. Listen to what Paul said in Romans 6, 5. For if we have become unified with Jesus in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be unified with him in the likeness of his resurrection. Every issue and boulder you could possibly face, you know how you overcome it? By faith. By faith in Jesus. So the question today is simply this. Where's your faith? Where is your faith? The only way you can overcome the boulders of this life is if you put faith in Christ. Where's your faith? Where's your faith? A boxer was getting beat up. He's getting beat up pretty bad. First round happens, and all of a sudden he had a cut on his lip. He went back to the corner, and his coach said, he ain't even touch you, man. You're gonna be all right. He ain't even touch you. Went back out for the second round. Swollen eye and a cyst on the side of his head. He stumbled back into the corner. Man, you got him right where you want him. You got him right where you want him. Get back out there, man. You got him right where you want him. And all of a sudden, he go back out, punch him in the stomach, punch him in the chin, knock the tooth out. He stumbles to the side. He ain't even touch you, man. He ain't even touch you. The boxer said, well, you need to check that referee because somebody is killing me out there. Tell you, I'm grateful the race of faith isn't dependent on our own strength. Jesus said, move out of the way and put your faith in me. Matthew 11 said, Jesus said, come to me if you're weary, burdened, and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke, for my yoke is easy and my boulders are light. You see, when you put your trust in Christ,
He carries the load of each and every boulder that you may have. It doesn't matter if it's sin. It doesn't matter what distress it is. It doesn't matter what it is. Quit getting beat up by the world. Go sit down somewhere and let Jesus fight your battles. Put your trust in Him that He'll stay up while you're sleeping. He'll be the one that's carrying the load. You just got to put your trust in Him. By faith is how you overcome. Got two questions for two different people. Have you ever put your faith in Jesus Christ? Have you ever put your faith in Jesus Christ? Maybe you've never said, man, I believe Jesus, my life is yours. You fought the battle that I kept losing at. You will carry the boulder that I can't carry. The ultimate weight of sin has to be given to Jesus. That's the only way you can make it through this life. Have you ever put your trust in Jesus? Simply have a conversation with God and say, today I know I've been carrying sin that I shouldn't be carrying. I've been carrying the weight of problems, of issues, depression, all sorts of stuff in 2023. But today, second Sunday of 2024, God, this boulder belongs to you. Jesus, you paid the price. Why am I continuing to get beat up by life? Have a conversation with God. Surrender your life to Him. But maybe you've already put your trust in Christ and you simply need to make a commitment to walk with Jesus. Maybe you got some weights that God brought to your mind that He's challenged you today. Put down this weight because it ain't helping you run the race. If that's you, man, God hears you. And the Holy Spirit will give you everything that you need to run this race freely. It may be sin, maybe an encumbrance, maybe an issue, a problem that you're trying to figure out on your own. And God is saying, will you truly give it over to me today and walk with God? Run this race without an encumbrance. Run this race without any weights on you so that you can truly finish this race well. Stand to your feet, every eye closed, every head bowed. Every eye closed. Prayer warriors, come on up front. Prayer warriors, come up front. Every eye closed, every eye closed, every head bowed. The altar is open, but I'm gonna give two specific calls. If you're at a place today where you say, today, Pastor, I'm putting my trust in Jesus. Do it right where you are. Jesus, I trust you. I trust you as my Lord, my Savior. I'm not carrying the boulder of sin, the boulder of my problems any longer. I'm coming to you because I'm weary, I'm burdened down. I'm heavy laden with these boulders. But you promised to give me rest if I give it over to you. Today, I trust Jesus as Lord and Savior. Put your trust in Him. If you did that today, I just ask you to come forward. I ask you to come forward and let one of these prayer warriors know, today I put my trust in Jesus. Somebody may be thinking, well, Pastor, can't I do that in private? Well, not really. Jesus said, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father who is in heaven. You can't privately be a Christian. You gotta publicly acknowledge, I've given my life to Jesus. My first challenge is put your trust in Him. Eyes are closed. If that's you, step out and publicly proclaim, today I put my trust in Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. Now, some of you are saying, Pastor, I know I got some boulders, some weights that I've been carrying. And I got to lay this boulder down. I got to get rid of this weight. You know what it is. You know what's on your list. That thing that's not helping you run a good race. That thing that's not helping you run a good race. God is, the Spirit has brought something in your mind right now. Something that you're saying, God, I'm dealing with this. This is a boulder and a weight that will not keep me away from this journey. And by faith, it's got to fall off. By faith, it's got to fall off. You got it. You know what it is. You know what it is. Now, here's my challenge to you, since you're really wanting to rededicate your walk with God. You're wanting to get rid of this weight. Here's my challenge to you. My challenge to you is this. Is there somebody that you know that you really respect their walk with God? Somebody that you know that you really respect their walk with God? Will you open up to them and say, God wants me to let go of this weight? You see, we're supposed to bear one another's burdens. We're supposed to bear one another's burdens. We're not supposed to carry things on our own. The church is here to be a safe place to carry boulders with you. So if God has put somebody in this church or somebody on your mind, my challenge to you is open up to them and say, God is saying, I gotta let go of this weight. They're gonna be there to pray for you. They're gonna be there to give you wisdom. They're gonna be there to encourage you on this journey. By faith, that's how you overcome boulders. By faith, that's how you overcome boulders.